Hi, everyone, and welcome to our first GoLab event of 2021. We are so happy you could join us this year. So GoLab is a series of events dedicated to Go, the open source programming language developed by Google, which is simple, efficient, and fast. And GoLab is organized by Develer, which is a company that develops hardware and software in the industrial field with a great focus on emerging and open source technologies. And Develer strongly believes in the role of training and collaboration. And because of this, it regularly organizes technology events such as conferences, workshops, and courses dedicated to technologies, such as our talk today, Your First Go Project from Zero to Hero. We'll have Fabio come on in just a moment. Before that, though, I just have a few announcements for you all. So first, if you do have any connection problems or if any reason the stream stops, you can actually exit and go ahead and click on the join email button in the email to rejoin with your confirmation letter. Also, we'll be having about a 5-minute break halfway through the talk. And furthermore, at the end of the talk, we will have that Q&A session with a dedicated Q&A chat that will be other than the main chat. So we really please ask you to save all of your burning questions until the end when we open that special Q&A talk. And lastly, for networking, there is Discord. I see some people already on the server, so you can click above us above me to join us there. All right, so now I'll go ahead and bring on Fabio, and he will talk about your first Go project from Zero to Hero. Hi, Fabio. Welcome.
Hi, everybody.
All right. Well, you can take it from here. So have fun, everyone, and talk to you at the break time.
Okay. Thank you very much for introducing me. And thank you all for attending my talk. Now I'll just try to share my screen. Okay. Okay. You should see the presentation now, and please let me know on the chat if you're not viewing the presentation. Very well. I think we can start because I'm not hearing any complaints. So I think you all are able to see the presentation. In the meantime, you can see those slides on the web if you copy the first URL on your browser, and you will access a version of the slides where you can click on the link, so you can access also the two repositories that we will see as an example for the talk. The first one, BTools, and the second one, Yaus. I will explain the name of the repositories and their origin just in a minute. Okay, so I think we can go to the next slide. I hope everybody has copied the first link, but be sure that at the end of the talk you will receive all the material that you need to review the repositories, the talk, and everybody else. Who am I? My name is Fabio Falzoi. I work as a senior software engineer at Develer, and I write Go programs for the majority of the time when I'm at work, and also when I'm at home working on my personal projects. So I'm a Go developer all around from day to night. And in this talk, I would like to share my experience with you, speaking a little bit about how to structure your next Go project. Okay, I just introduced myself, and I would like to clarify a little bit who this webinar is for. This webinar is thought for someone that already grasp the Go programming language, at least at the basic level, so it is able to complete a tour of Go. You know, a tour of Go is a popular tutorial on the web from the Go team. that I suggest you to complete if you haven't already. And probably the most of you have already written something in Go, maybe some exercises on popular website like HackerRank, CodeWords, and something like that, or something like Gopher's size, or maybe you have already written some complete applications, but something that is quite small. And starting from there, you would like to know more about structure your next professional Go project. I'd say professional because, you know, at the end of the day, I think that a lot of you are professional developers that would like to experiment with what we will see now in your day job. But who knows, maybe you will experiment these patterns also for your open source project, I don't know. Very well. First of all, I would like to say that software is all about trade-offs, and especially when we are talking about architecture, project layout and something like that, it is even more a matter of a trade-off. So especially with Go, there is not what is called a standard layout for your project. We will see in a minute that, there is something that is called standard Go project layout, but it is not really a standard. It's just a set of well-known patterns that you can find in most repositories, in most projects. But apart from that, it's just a matter of make some choices. And in this talk, I would like to share with you my opinions and obviously my experience. But clearly, as I already said, these are just my opinions. So you need to apply what hopefully will be explained in this talk, just tailoring to your needs, because a certain decision can be the best one or the worst one, depending on the environment, on the context. Okay, so first of all, Go is often used for CLI applications and high-performance web services. So, since this is a webinar, I thought that a practical approach would be better to show the most common pattern to structure your application. Also, because you can find a lot of great material out there that regarding the project layout and regarding some common Go patterns, but sometimes it is quite difficult to apply those layout, those patterns in a real world scenario. So in this talk, I would like to code with you a couple of applications, or let's say that we'll just try to see how I've wrote a couple of applications. The first one is a CLI application, and the second one is just a very simple web service, just to share with you my thoughts, my choices, and also my opinion about the design choices I made. Obviously, the good ones and also the bad ones, because yes, I took some choices that I immediately regret, but anyway, we'll see in a moment. Okay, let's just start with the first application. The name is BTools. Let's clarify why this strange name. Some weeks ago, I read a nice article that I suggest to everybody about BitTorrent. The article was talking about developing a BitTorrent client written in Go in about a week, or maybe even less, a weekend, I think, but I don't remember very well. Anyway, I suggested the article because it's very well written. And the code the article is based on used a previously written BNCode data parser. Just to be clear, BNCode is the format that is used by the file that has a torrent extension. So when you want to download the file through the torrent protocol, using the torrent peer-to-peer protocol, you start with a .torrent file, and the format of that file is BNCode format. And despite being an easy format, it is said that there are not so many BNCode editors out there. So I thought maybe it would be a great idea to try to write by myself a BN code parser, starting from scratch, and after that try to develop a CLI application to that leverages this parser to decode and encode data from JSON to BN code format and the other way around. Okay, so this is the idea. Let's talk a little bit how to start our first project. First of all, in recent releases of Go, we should use module. Thanks to module, you can code your application outside of the OVR Go path, so you can be anywhere in our file system. You just use the Go mod tool to init your module, and executing this command will generate a go.mod file on your file system that will contain the path for the root module that is your application. Remember that a module is a collection of Go packages that are stored in a file tree with a Go mod that we just generated. What are the packages? Well, packages are simply a collection of Go source files that contains both exported and unexported constants, variables, functions, types, and so on. We will see some example in a moment. Think about the package is a package is just a part of a library that we are developing, that we are exporting. It is important to differentiate between exported and unexported things like constants, variables, and so on, because clearly what the users of your API will see outside your packages will be just the exported types, functions, and so on. Besides containing the import path for the root directory, your go.mod file will contain all the module dependencies, and we'll see that while we are developing and linking some external packages to complete our application, this go.mod file will include all the packages that our application depends on. Okay, so first of all, we have to define a layout for our project. Here you can find a link to the Go standard project layout. If you don't have the slides, you can just search for these words on Google, and the first result on GitHub will show you the layout I'm using. As I said, this is called standard, but to be true, it is not a standard in the strict term of the word. But it's just a very common used layout to write your Go application. You can find a lot of information on the Go standard project layout page. But what we are interested in now is just those directories that are maybe the most important to start developing our simple application. First of all, the package directory is aimed to contain the packages that are useful for our application, but also are useful for other applications. So if you write a package and you move a package inside the PKG directory, it's just telling to everybody else that, okay, this package is suitable to use outside of this project. It is generic enough and structured to be used outside of this project. And that is the reason why, as you can see on the right, I chose to expose the BNCode package, that is the implementation of the BNCode parser, in the PKG directory, because this package we are using the BNCode package here for our CLI application. But if you'd like to use that package also for example, for developing your own BitTorrent client, you can use that package. So this is the main distinction between the PKG directory and the internal directory. The internal directory will contain other packages, but these packages are more tailored to stay in this application and not in other applications, not in other module. So this is why I chose to put the torrent package here. We will see in a moment what the torrent package contains. But remember that internal is for internal packages and PKG is used for packages that are suitable to be used outside of this layout. An important point to note is that in this layout, you can't find a source directory or SRC directory. The SRC directory is very common if you come from a Java background, maybe even for a C or C++ background, but is not used, it is not used in Go, or to be more precise, it should not be used. And the reason why you should not use a source directory has its root before of the modules era. But anyway, this is considered still today an anti-pattern. So you can use a source directory. It's not that your application won't work if you use a source directory, but it's not the preferred layout. Keep in mind that here we are just trying to agree on a common layout, and agreeing on this layout is also useful if someone else come to read your code, and using this common layout is a way to ease the onboarding for other member of your team or someone else that would like to read and understand your code. So apart from the first three directories, other notable directories that are very useful are, well, the build one, where we will put all our generated binaries for the application. And even more important is the command directory, cmd1, because usually you will put all the main.go files that will generate your binary in this directory. In this case, this application will compile itself in a single binary named bTools. And as you can see, under the command directory, I have a directory bTools with a file main.go. It is a good practice to keep your main.go file as simple as possible. So in your main.go file, you should just maybe read the configuration and try to compose your application using the packages that you developed, and then run your application to get the result you want. Another interesting directory that you can find is test. If you look again at the package directory, you can see that inside the bncode directory, you can find a bncode_test.go file. That's because your unit test will have their place close to the package you are testing. So the test for the bncode package, the unit testing for the bncode parser, will be there close to the bncode code. Instead, under the test directory, you can have your integration testing, your end-to-end testing, your system testing, and also, as we will see later, I will put in this directory the result of the coverage for our unit testing. Finally, another directory that is useful is the assets directory, where you will store something like additional images. I think in the repository for bTools, I have an image that is just the logo of the application, and assets is the preferred directory to save this kind of additional assets. Okay, so let's talk now a little bit about the code of our application. Just let's try to develop our bncode parser. First of all, what is the bncode format? I already introduced it, but I'd like to share the definition from Wikipedia. When you read a file with a .torrent extension, you will find a BN code format. You will find the data in the BN code format. You can think of this format as something similar to JSON, but a little bit different. We just a tiny different layout. Specifically, the BN code format exposes four different data types. The first one is byte string, that is comparable to the Go strings. The second one is the integer data type that can have negative and positive values, and is very similar to an int type in the Go programming language. Then we have two structured types that are lists and dictionaries. And as you can see, the list starts with an L character and ends with an E character, and every single element of the list is another type of the BN from the BN code data types. So it can be a byte string, an integer, another list, so a sublist, and another possibly another dictionary. And finally, there are the dictionaries, again, just like the list. Those types are composite data types, so you can find a lot of types inside these. And just like list, we have a starting character that is D for dictionaries, and an ending character that is E for just like for the list. E is the ending character for integer lists and dictionaries. Here you can find a simple example where a single dictionary holds a key that is always a byte string that points to an integer, and another key, the B key. I just like to remember that the keys for dictionaries are always byte string. And the second key, B, is referring to another byte string that is test. Okay, so now that we have a clearer idea about the specification for our BN code parser, let's try to think about how we would like to structure our application. As I said, we will use a separate package for our parser, and we'll try to code our parser to map each BN code type to a custom Go struct type. And in doing so, each one of our struct type will satisfy a couple of hand interfaces that are included in the Go standard library in the encoding package, that are binary marshaller and binary unmarshaller. Why I'm doing this? Because doing this, our types can be marshalled and unmarshalled even using other encoders like GOB or JSON and so on. So it's just a convenient way to make our types useful in multiple encodings. Okay, let's have a closer look to the code of the BN code package. First of all, we will start defining some constant. And you can see that this constant starts with a capital letter. So in doing so, we are exporting our constants. This has two main objectives. The first one is that defining those constants makes the code more readable, because using literal values directly, using a lot of literal values direct in your code can make the code more obscure, and clearly we don't want that. So we will define some constants to make the code more readable. And besides, I decided to define those constants and as exported, because I think that it can be useful even outside of the package, just to know the starting character for each encoded BN code data types. And after that, we define also a couple of errors. And this is another nice pattern, because in doing so, When we will return errors, you can see that here we have two couple of errors that may arise while marshalling or are marshalling the data that comes from the input. In doing so, we can, the users of our API can check the specific error our API is generating just using the is function, the is API of the errors package. And I'm just showing here in this slide how the user of our API can do that. And clearly, the user of our API would like to do that because sometimes you would like to take different behavior depending on the specific error you are receiving from the API. So clearly, this is a nice way to do that. Okay, so let's start by marshalling our integer. Let's see the implementation of the marshal binary methods for our integer data type. It is very simple. You can see that to marshal an integer value, we have to write the first byte, that is the integer start byte, that is just I byte. And after that, we need to convert the value to a byte format. And after that, we need to write the final byte, that is the e byte, the integer end byte. So this is the simple implementation of the marshal binary for the integer data type. Just like the integer data type, the code for marshalling the byte string type is very similar. The only difference is that we need to know the length of the string we would like to encode to write in the output buffer. Then we will have to append the separator. And here you can see that I made an error because I just used the literal colon. And instead, I should use the defined literal as the defined const as I showed before. But anyway, after that, we'll just write the contents of our string to obtain the serialized data 8:bTools. Okay. Here we can see the implementation of the unmarshal binary methods for the byte string. And it is a little bit more complicated. And as you can see, I decided to split the internal part of this API in an unexported API. And I do that because when I try to unmarshal a dictionary or a list that is a composite data type, I need to recursively call the unmarshalling function of all the data types that are inside the composite data type. So having those unmarshal function helped me to structure my code. The unmarshalling of the composite data type is a little bit more complicated, and we won't see that in the slide. Maybe I will show just a little bit of that later when we examine the repository on GitHub. But anyway, if you're curious, all the code is available on GitHub and is available for seeing and also for trying, because it should be compiled and run correctly. At least I hope so. Well, okay. Let's assume that we completed our marshalling and unmarshalling functions, and now we have a complete parser for the bncode data types, for integer, for byte strings, for dictionaries, and lists. Since now we just have a package, we don't have an entire application, but we just wrote quite a lot of code. And it is a good practice to avoid writing too much code without testing it. So I think that, even if we are not following a TDD pattern in developing our code, it is a good time now to write the tests for our parser. In doing so, typically, what you want to do, you want to take the first one of your data type, let's say the integer data type, and you would like to try some values just to make sure that the implementation you coded is correct. And typically, you will start with the zero value and probably go on with a negative value, a very large value, or also, let me say, a standard value in just for a value that is very common to see for your API. In doing so, you are trying to testing your code just for a lot of edge cases and also for some usual case. And if you write the test as you see now in the slide, you can see that you are repeating a lot of code, because for each of these value, you need to repeat all the code of the test. And this is quite annoying, but we can improve this a lot. Go gives us the possibility to write table-driven tests that are very useful, because allow us to keep it dry, that is, don't repeat yourself. And also, I think writing table-driven tests optimize a lot your testing code for glanceability and readability, because despite the testing code that you can assume is working, just picture in your mind that this code is already in place. You come to read it, and you just want to do a little change to the code, and you would like to exercise this change just adding a specific test. If table-driven tests are already used, you can just add another test just by completing the list of test cases that you can find on the left of this slide. As you can see here, I'm just instantiating a slice of struct, each of which contains a name for the subtest, the input I need to execute the test, and the expected values for the test. And in doing so, I just write my test using the t.run API of the testing.t type, passing to it the name of the subtest and a function that will execute the specific subtest. In doing so, the Go test tool will format the output very nicely. And here you can see all of these tests that I wrote for the integer data types that are executed at, and luckily they are passing. So this is a way of writing tests that is very common. It is very handy, both from a point of readability and also from a point of like stimulating the other teammate in write the most complete test possible to reach a very high coverage of your code. Okay, the same apply to benchmarking, because specifically for this case we are talking about a parser, so it is important just to have some reference number regarding the performance of our parser, and maybe it is more important in the lifetime of this parser to keep those numbers as low as possible, or at least to avoid worsening the performance of our parser too much. So, in my opinion, it is important for this kind of package to write as soon as possible, just like unit testing, your benchmark. And luckily, you can leverage the same table-driven design for both your tests and also your benchmark. In this case, I'm just showing you a simple benchmark for the unmarshal function of the BMCode parser. But in this case, I'm not using table-driven benchmarks just because, I was a bit lazy, so I didn't write a lot of benchmark for this package. But anyway, I can assure you that you can use the same pattern for both your tests and your benchmark. A nice thing to say is that you may know that Go is a memory-managed language. Go has a garbage collector that avoid you to leak in memory while you do not you don't have a reference to the allocated memory anymore. And since the garbage collector needs to scan all the heap for the allocated memory, keeping the total size of allocated memory low helps us in achieving better performance. So you will find a strict correlation between the total size of allocated memory and the performance of your applications and your API. That's why a handy API that the Go testing tool gives us is report allocs that enable additional memory allocation statistics for this specific benchmark. You can obtain the same result with a specific flag that is benchmem.something. I don't remember it very well. While executing your benchmarks, but if you'd like to show additional memory statistics just for a specific benchmark, you just need to call this API in the specific benchmark you'd like to know the memory allocation statistics. Okay, just a little disclaimer. Well, it is clear now that the BNCode package I've wrote and that you can see in the on the repository on GitHub, it is not optimized for high performance, but just for readability. As a matter of fact, I just try to compare it with some existing implementation of a BNCode parser that you can find still on GitHub. And well, sadly, it is a little bit more slow and a little bit more hungry for memory. So, well, I think I need to improve that a little bit in the future. But anyway, here I'm just showing the result of calling GoTest with the flag minus bench to run my benchmark. As you can see, you get a lot of information. Specifically, here we are executing two benchmarks. The first one is for the Marshall part, so we're trying to encode data in binary format, in binary BNCode format, and the second one for their marshalling, we are trying to extract data from binary BNCode format. And the Go framework will try to execute your function many times, while doing this, it will stop while reaching a certain threshold and assuring that the result of the benchmark is stable enough to be shown to you. And here you can see some useful information like nanosecond per operation taken to execute the benchmark. And the other two information are the total number of bytes per operation, total number of bytes allocated per operation, and the number the total number of allocations that are done for each operation. So these are the number that we will need to lower in case we want better performance. The benchmark will give you useful information, but won't say much why your code is running too slow, if that's the case. And if you want to have more information, you have to rely on the Go tool pprof to generate a profile of your code, or just on the trace tool just to trace your code to see what is happening. Specifically, a lot of times you are interested to see when the garbage collector is kicking in, why, and for how much time. But anyway, those topics are outside of the scope of this talk. I'm just pointing you to those two tools if you'd like to know more about improving performances for your packages. Okay, so we completed the BNCode parser package. We have a functioning BNCode parser, a parser that is closed in its package. It is reasonably tested. We'll show later that the coverage for this package is quite fair. We also developed some benchmark for our BNCode package. And now we would like to we would like to decode some .torrent file to and exercise the VN code parser to see if we can effectively read some .torrent file. So we need to decide where to put those definition, and those definition you are seeing is just the struct, the new types that are defining the contents of a .torrent file. If you open a .torrent file, you will find those structure with announce, comment, creation date, a list of all the seeds of all the seeds where we can start getting the pieces of our of the file we want. And inside the info, you will find a substruct with a lot of information regarding the pieces of the file that you are looking about. I decided for this project to separate the information regarding the torrent file from the BNCode data parser. And that is because I consider the BNCode parser to be a generic parser for the BNCode data format that is quite separated from the rest of the torrent related technicalities. So I decided to write a new package, a torrent package, that I will put in the internal directory, because I consider this package to be specific for the BTools CLI application. Okay, well, this is the this is one reason, but to be honest, the main reason was that I needed some excuses to show you how to structure your layout if you have multiple packages. So, to be honest, you should avoid to fragment your package too much. And you should not be afraid of having packages with a lot of lines of code. So in this case, I decided to extract the information regarding the torrent file. But to be honest, we could also even put the information for the torrent file in the BNCode package, and probably it would be a better choice. As I said, it's just a matter of taking some choices, and in this case, I was forced to take this choice because I would like to show you how to manage a repository with multiple packages. Okay, so what we would like to achieve with a function in BNCode parser and a description of the content of a .torrent file is an application usable from the CLI to decode our .torrent file to JSON and to encode our JSON file to a .torrent file. Here you can see the very simple implementation of decode. And the nice thing to note here is that decode is accepting a couple of interfaces, specifically an IO writer and an IO reader, to be generic enough to make it more testable and more usable if you want to read input and also write output from file, from memory, and so on. We will see in the repository that this choice is a very good one when you're writing your API. Always try to accept interfaces and return concrete types. This will give your APIs a nice flexibility that will come real handy while testing and while integrating your API in a more complex project. Okay, and here you can see the implementation for the encode function. What we are doing here is simply trying to open, trying to decoding the input we are reading from the RIO reader into a torrent data structure. And after that, we are calling a specific todict API just to marshaling the representation of our BNCoded data inside the just to marshal the representation of our JSON data in a BNCode format. And finally, I'm calling the encoder of the BNCode package that I developed to encode those data in the bncode binary format. That's it. Very, very easy, very, very easy to understand and to read. Okay, so the main purpose of this application is to build a CLI application. When you build a CLI application, it is better to stick to some known pattern in managing your CLI application. And that's because, you know, it's better to stick to some kind of how can I say, to some kind of family feeling while using CLI application. So maybe a lot of you are used to Git. Are used to the Go tools, and so it is better to stick with that CLI standard also while developing your application. That's because the user of your application will try to stick to the same pattern while using your application. So if you write your application in a way that resembles the CLI of Git and the Go tools, you achieve immediately a better usability of your application and also a better a wider adoption of your application. But to do so, you would have to code a lot of things just to make available something that is very common to those CLI applications, like an help command that will drive the user of your application in specifying the right parameters, a management for the parameters and the flags, or maybe you would like to implement some validation, like this subcommand requires exactly two parameters, these other subcommands require just one parameter, and so on. And to do so, luckily, we can leverage a nice package that is called Cobra. And Cobra is a package just to write CLI, very nice CLI application in Go. And to be true, is something more. It is also a framework to structure your CLI application. And it also has a part that will generate the scaffolding of your application, sticking to the standard structure of the Cobra CLI application. In this case, I will stick to the Go standard project layout I showed earlier, but you may want to give Cobra a try, even regarding the structure of your application, if you don't like the Go standard project layout. Anyway, the two layouts are very similar. Now let's just see how we can use Cobra to build our CLI application. We would like to write three subcommands. The first one is the code, as you can see from the auto-generated help on the right side of the slide. The first one is the help command that will show this output. The other one is the show command that will take a .torrent file and will show the metadata of the torrent file without showing all the data that is inside the torrent file, specifically the pieces field of the torrent structure I showed before. And after that, we would like to have the decode subcommand and the encode subcommand that, well, surprisingly enough, we'll try to decode data stored in a .torrent file. And also, encode will try to encode data taken from a JSON file. In doing so, our CLI app will help ourselves to transform our bncode data to JSON data and leverages all the already developed application for JSON data to modify the data stored in bncode format. How we can achieve that with Cobra? Well, while developing a CLI application in Cobra, it is it is a common pattern to just stick in the main.go file, specifically in your main function, just the definition of all of your subcommand. Here I'm just showing the encode command for brevity, because I don't have so much space on the slide, but you can refer to the repository on GitHub to see the implementation of all the commands. And after that, at the end of the main function, we just need to link all this command to the main root command, that is btools in this case. And Cobra gives us the possibility to specify a short help string, a longer help string, and also to validate, as I'm doing now, to validate the number and the types of our arguments. And in this case, as you can see on the left side for the encode command, I'm just defining a subcommand that takes from 0 to a maximum of 2 arguments. Specifically, if I take 0 arguments, the btools encode subcommand will try to read input from the standard input and will write output to the standard output, that is very common for a CLI application. But if you specify additional parameters up to 2 parameters, the btools CLI application will try to read from the first parameter and write to the second parameter, assuming that those parameters are regular file path on our file system. Okay, so we just navigate the layout of our btools application, and we saw how to structure our inner packages, the bncode parser, how to structure the other package, the torrent package, to read the specific format of torrent files. And we also saw how to test the packages, how to run benchmark. And here you can see also the commands you should run to lint your code and to get a coverage report for your code. Since it is quite annoying to repeat those commands and specifying all the options you usually want to run those commands, a very common way to ease those steps, and also a way to ease the automation of those steps in a continuous integration environment, is to use a makefile. Well, to be honest, the syntax of the makefile is not easy, and there are many alternatives with simpler syntax, but makefiles are also widespread, and it is quite easy to find great makefiles for a normal Go project on the web. Or, if you'd like, you can start from this for your next project, and you will also have a makefile that is already ready to compile your application for your local architecture, that is able to run the standard linter, that is able to run your test, your benchmarks, and also is able to run a local server on the port 8080 to serve the documentation of your application. So I think this is enough for a nice project. Okay, so just to summarize what we've done since now, here is the final structure of the btools application. As I said, we are following the Go standard project layout with the assets, build, command, internal, package, directories, and some other things to note here is that the go.mod and go.sum files that are related to the management of our application modules are on the root path of our application, together with the makefile and clearly our readme. And apart from that, a nice thing to note is the test data folder under the btools package. To be honest, this is a questionable choice because I said earlier that integration test and end-to-end test should belong to the test folder. Here, I just leverage some API, some unexported API, specifically encode and decode in the main.go. In the BTools main package, to add an integration test that starting from a .torrent file, that is the .torrent file for the latest release of the Debian operating system. This integration test try to decode those data and encode that in a JSON file, and again open the JSON file and re-encode the data back to a torrent file, and finally just check that the final result we are obtaining is exactly the same we started from, just to check that the entire way from torrent to JSON and JSON to torrent is functioning well, is working as expected. And to be honest, this was, in my opinion, quite a poor decision, because it would have been better to move those kind of tests in the test folder and to treat it as a system test and just call the compiled version of our program. But anyway, a final word on the test data folder. The test data folder is a special name for the Go tooling suite, because if the Go tool find a directory that is named test data, this will be ignored. So it is a handy name if you want to store some files that are useful for some complicated testing that you want to do against your application. In this case, I needed a real torrent file just to be sure that my application is able to manage a real torrent file. Okay, so we talked a lot about our application. Let's try now to have a look at the GitHub repositories, just to show you some things that are better explained with the code in front of us. Okay, so let's switch to the BTools repository. You should see the BTools repository now, and you can get it at this URL: github.com/people84/BTools. Okay, so what I would like to show about this. As I said, here under command, you can find in main.go the implementation of the BTools command, that is the single executable that will be generated from the build of our application. And as I said before, the main file is just used to create the encode Cobra subcommand with a function that is implementing this command, just calling the encode function, passing it a suitable reader or writer depending on the arguments. And here you can see the decode command, and the structure is just the same. And finally, the show command. The structure is just the same I told before while showing the slides. Here you can see that all these subcommands are wired together with the root command that will be just the BTools. This is the standard way to develop a Cobra CLI application. It is very simple. Clearly, the Cobra package is very complicated. We're just scratching the surface of it, but this is how you will start using Cobra for your next CLI application. Apart from that, I would like to show a little bit just a quick demo of the tool. We can build our project. And also, we can have a coverage report of our code. And here we can see that maybe doing so you can read better. Here you have a list of the file, and as you can see, some files are not tested very well because it was a little bit lazy, but the bncode file, that is the file related to the bncode parser, is tested well, quite well. We reached the coverage of 75%, that is at least fair. And in this representation that is generated by the GoTool cover, you can see that you can have information about which lines of code are tested and which line of code is not tested. Okay, so just a quick demonstration of the tool. So okay, command B tools. Let's just take the file regarding the torrent file I was talking before. Just now, okay. Okay, now we can use our help to remember how to launch the application. And we can call the show subcommand and give the parameter. Debian, okay. And here we are. The application is showing us in a nicely formatted way the information that are inside the .torrent file. Okay, so I think this is enough for the first application. So it's time for a little break now. I'm a little bit longer, but let's just take a little break and we will continue with the other application later.
Excellent. Thank you so much. All right, everyone, time for a small 5-minute break, but I do have an announcement first, and that is that we have published a course on the Go website that you can see at in just a minute, and the tickets will be available starting next Monday, the 29th, so you can go to the GoLab site and go ahead and check it out. All right, thanks, everyone. We'll see you in 5. Okay, everyone, welcome back from the break. We'll go ahead and start with Fabio back in just a moment. And until then, I also wanted to say, please, 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 I know you have a lot of burning questions. We will save them till the end. So please go ahead and keep those free from our chat. We'll have a dedicated chat for them afterwards. So I'll go ahead and give you a moment. As soon as Fabio is back, we'll go ahead and get started. All right, there you are. See you after the rest.
Very well. I think we can start again with the rest of the talk. I saw some questions on the chat, and I can assure you that some of the questions will be answered in the second part of the talk. So if you resist to the end of the talk, hopefully some of our questions will be answered early. Okay, so let's see another example of a classical application to develop with Go, an HTTP service. The strange name for the HTTP service I decided to show you is because this one is, surprisingly enough, I would like to say, yet another URL shortener. And probably a lot of you has seen something similar because it's a very typical exercise that is completed when you're trying to learn Go. And but I think it is useful just to focus more on the structure of the application and a little bit less on the logic of the application, because I know that the first part of the talk was a little bit intense regarding the code and the technicalities of the application I showed. Okay, so first of all, let's start by saying that this is not a great shortener because it is not able to shorten about anything. But as I said, it's just an example application. And here first of all, I have to say to myself that I deserve this face palm. And just because here you can see that I'm using the MD5 digest algorithm to take an URL. You can see that from the first HTTP request. I'm just asking it to the HTTP service to shorten the URL HTTP www.google.it. And it is giving me back in a JSON format an MD5 digest of the URL. And after that, I can make another request, a GET request to the server, just to get redirected to the URL that was saved before. But as you can see, the original URL is shorter than the shortened one. So it is not a great URL shorter, but anyway, this is just an application example. Okay, first of all, let's introduce some packages that may be useful to develop your typical HTTP service, your typical web service. Typically, you will need a request router just to match the HTTP request to the handler you are going to write. And a great one is GorillaMux. Probably you will need some form of persistent data storage. There are a lot of databases. A lot of you for sure know, I don't know, Postgres, MySQL, MariaDB, and a lot of databases. Here I'm just using a persistent key value store that is entirely written in Go, that is BadgerDB. I used it in the past, and I think it is great. It is quite fast, and it is used by the dgraph company for the rest of their products. So it is well battle tested, and I think it is suitable for a production service. Then we will show a little bit of Viper for configuration management, and finally we will see also the Zap package from Uber for structured logging. As I said, there are many alternatives. These are just my preferences that I would like to share with you. And the good point of this is that you can take the code I've wrote for the Yahoo service as a little example how to use those packages, or well, similar one, in your project. Okay, first of all, Gorilla Max. Gorilla Max gives us the possibility to the possibility to have variables specified in our path, and in this example, I'm just trying to get the hash variable that the user of my API is specifying while asking to shorten an URL. Or sorry, I'm just taking the hash variable just to take it and return the shortened URL that was saved before. So as you can see, this is the redirect handler. That is the handler I'm just returning a little bit back that used for these for the second request, where the server gives me back a redirect. Okay, so another thing that is very useful is that there are a lot of matches, and here I'm matching the method get to my handler registered as redirect. So this is just one of the many methods that Gorilla Max gives us to match requests with the proper handler. Okay, regarding BadgeDB, is a typical key value store, and here you can see a basic use of BadgeDB, where I can I'm just writing a key value pair with an update transaction, a read write transaction, and I'm reading the key that was stored before with a read only transaction. It is very simple to use in this basic case, at least. Okay, Viper is a very good package for configuration management, and specifically if you're trying to develop 12-factor app, that is app that are ready for the modern era. Let me see that, or at least this is what the 12-factor is aiming. The point three of the 12-factor states that you should store configuration in the environment. Well, Viper supports many ways of reading configuration from files, from environment, and in this specific use case, I'm using Viper just to have a handy default configuration for my development setup. Specifically, as you can see in the last three lines, I'm setting Viper to read a default configuration, config.yaml, from the directories configs.devel. And I think this is a useful pattern just to set a default configuration while you are developing your application. But apart from that, you can also specify some defaults for your application, and also you can also get configs values from the environment, and also specify a prefix that will be used for all your environment variables. In this case, if you want to pass the secret config value to the application, you will have to use yaus_secret in all uppercase. Okay, finally, the ZAP package that is used for structured logging. And the reason why I'm using this package is two main reasons. The first is that it's cool to have structured logging with a lot of information. ZAP exposes sound defaults, and you can have a lot of information, useful information while logging data for your application. And also, ZAP gives us the possibility to use a very fast logger that is suitable to be used in your hot path, that is in the part of your code that needs to keep the maximum performance. If you use the sugared logger, as it is called, as I'm doing in this example. This sugar logger is faster than the log standard package, standard library implementation. But if you don't use the sugared logger, you will have a reflection-free zero location JSON encoder that will make the logger suitable for the hot path. So you can keep logging quite a lot, even if you have some constraints regarding the performance. Okay, here we can see a quick example of how Zap will generate the logging for our application. We can see that the level of our the level of our trace is output. Then TS stays for the timestamp from the, in this case, just the, a timestamp. I think it is from the Unix epoch, but I'm not sure. And this is a very nice information, the color information that gives us the specific point where this line was called. And after that, there are some customizable fields that we can specify to enrich our log. In this case, I'm just writing the default configuration from our service. Okay, regarding the structure we need for our HTTP service, we'll go again for the Go standard project layout, so no surprise on this side. First of all, we would like to implement the graceful shutdown pattern for our server. That's because it is important to make sure that when the server will be stopped with the signal, all the already running requests will be completed, and the eventual outcome will be persisted to our storage. Besides, keep in mind that you should not start a new goroutine without knowing how it will stop. And every time someone will issue a request to your server, a new goroutine is instantiated to serve that request. So this pattern helps us to keep things nice and clean. So we'll see how to implement this later. Okay, so for the first attempt to structure our application, we can just think about, since it is simple enough, just declare a type server with a strict dependency to our BadgerDB, and just start coding with the server, with the HTTP handler that will keep all the logic of the application inside the handler themselves. But if you think a little bit about the solution, even if it should be fine for a simple application like that, well, that is not guaranteeing us the testability and the modularity that we will seek for more complex application. In fact, just picture in mind that you are implementing a logic that is a little bit more complex, or maybe you are implementing a microservices fleet that needs to share some functionalities, like, as an example, the graceful shutdown logic. If you're doing so, with this structure, it is really difficult to test the various part of your code, that is, the server part, the logic that are, in this case, is just how I shorten the URL, and also try to mock the storage backend that, in this case, is the BadgerDB. Okay, so to improve the stability and the modularity of our code, we can just define a simple interface in the storage package, an interface that is called backend, just to enclose the specific method of BadgerDB to get and put a new pair of key value on our storage. And this will give us the possibility to easily swap our storage backend with another database, another key value store. We will have just to write the implementation of the get and put function for a newer backend. And this also will give us the possibility to easily mock the storage while testing our application without relying on a real BadgerDB that we write is data on disk. Okay, regarding the business logic, again, here you have to think that this is a very simple logic. We are just trying to shorten a URL, but if you need to implement some complicated logic, it is a nice way to do so is try again to use an interface to decouple even more the logic of the server that is dealing with HTTP requests and responses from the inner logic, the inner business logic of your application. So in this case, I'm just defining a simple Usher interface, and I'm trying to keep those interfaces very small because, you know, if you have a big interface with a lot of methods, probably your interface is not very well built. In this case, it is a nice interface because it just have one method, and also it is very easy for our specific type to implement this interface. And I'm implementing very well, as I said, not a not so smart shortener based on the MD5 digest algorithm. And this will keep a good testability because it will be very easy to test this specific implementation of our shortener algorithm. Okay, so as a second attempt, our server for our service should be structured just like that. We will encapsulate an HTTP server. I decided to do that. It is not mandatory, it's clear, but I decided to do that just to expose some run and shutdown method to support the graceful shutdown pattern. And after that, in our server struct, we will have some dependencies for a generic shortener that it is simple, an object able to satisfy the Usher interface, a generic cache that is a type that is able to satisfy our backend interface, but we don't enforce anything regarding how it is the specific backend is satisfying this interface. And finally, a pointer to our logger. Okay, here you can see the implementation of the graceful shutdown pattern. We just use a separate coroutine to listen and serve the requests from our server, and just using the errors channel to relay all the error from the HTTP server to the caller of our API. And finally, we are exposing the shutdown API to give the caller the possibility to shut down in a clean way our server. Specifically, this shutdown method accepts a context that is passed to the shutdown API of the server, and this context may be used to set a timeout. That is, we are shutting down our server, but we don't want to wait more than as an example, 30 seconds, because after that we consider that our server is stuck and we want to forcibly close the server. And besides, the shutdown method also accepts a wait group just to signal to the user of our API when the process of shutdown is complete. Okay, the core of our application is an HTTP server. So let's have a look at how we should structure our handlers. First of all, again, I would like to stress that this is an example. So this is a very simple application, and some choices I made for this application may appear to be just over-engineering. And in this specific case, you are right. This is a little bit over-engineered, but I'm trying to show you some useful patterns to keep your bigger projects more maintainable. In this case, I'm just defining all the function, all the handlers using, generating the function handler, just calling a method on our server. So what I'm doing here specifically, I call the shortened method on the server, and then I return the real handler, the real HTTP handler as a separate function. This function is able to access all the method from the server just because the S reference is captured as a closure in this from the inner HTTP handler function. And this gives us a nice structure for our handler, because here I can keep the request definition, the request structure, and the response structure close to the handler without polluting the rest of our server package with a lot of structure for various requests and various responses for different handlers. And besides, if you look at the implementation of this handler, you will see that each handler will assume a similar pattern in decoding the request, applying the requesting logic, and finally encoding the response. So this is a nice way to structure your handler. Okay, so another thing that is useful using this pattern is just here in the in calling handler, I can set up something that is specific for this particular handler. And I can just do that in a lazy way this function is called to create the handler. Beware that in doing so, since we will have a different goroutine for each request, the things that we are accessing in these steps needs to be protected from data races. So be sure that the data on your server is protected from data races if you are accessing it from multiple goroutines. Okay, here we can find an example of how we can unit testing our HTTP server. As I said before, it is very easy to create a mock backend for our storage. And that is nice because we can test the server without using a real support for our storage. So we don't have to pollute our file system. As you know, a good unit testing should not write on the file system. And in this way, we can just easily mock our backend, and we can also control our backend to make sure that the backend is receiving the data we would like it to receive for the specific unit test we are coding. And we can also do the same for the business logic, because in this test we are interested to specifically testing the HTTP handlers, and so we are not testing the business logic that belongs to another package. Okay, so this is the implementation of a test for the redirect handler. And here I'm using the very handy HTTP test.newRecorder. NewRecorder is a type that you can find on the HTTP test package from the standard library. And this type is able to record the request from your handler. As you can see here, I'm just calling my handler with a request that I'm constructing specifically for this test. Then I'm recording through the recorder the response from my handler. And finally, I'm inspecting the status code and the header of the response, just to make sure that the server has read as expected. So as you can see here, using our mock backend and mock shortener, it is very easy to separate the concerns and test each part of our code. Okay, before reasoning a little bit about the general structure of this HTTP service, I would like to share with you another pattern that I consider to be very useful. We saw that our server has some mandatory dependencies, specifically storage and hash to generate the proper hash for the URL that we need to shorten, and finally a logger. But it also has some additional options. Specifically, if you look at the code, you will see some options regarding the timeout that we want to set for our HTTP server, the write timeout, read timeout, and so on. In this case, we would like to have a ready-to-use instance while calling a very simple API, something like yaus.newserver, but we would also like to easily customize our server if needed and not use our defaults. Okay, we have some. We can try a lot of things, and I'll try to show you some patterns that you can try, starting from the one that works not very well in my opinion, and finally with the one that you can also find the code that is, in my opinion, very very clean and very neat. First of all, you can simply try to add some additional function to create a new default server, but with the ability to set specific options. This is fine if you have very few options, but again, think about a production service that is more complicated than our simple URL shortener. If you, in doing so, it is very difficult to give all the API that will be needed to set all the possible options for our server. So this way of giving the ability to the user of our API, the possibility to specify options is not so clean because it will pollute your code in a very fast way. A nice pattern that you can find quite a lot is just to specify a config structure where you can store all the default values. In my opinion, there is nothing so wrong in using this pattern. I used it a lot in the past and even now. The point is that if you'd like to call the most simple API that is possible to get a server with some sensible defaults value, you still have to pass an empty configuration structure. And since usually the user of your API will stick to the default values for the most of their time, this can get quite annoying. A better thing to do, in my opinion, is to use the functional options pattern. This pattern gives us a way to specify a variable number of options just using a functional approach. Specifically, you can see that the new server function accepts a variadic number of options. So you can specify zero if you want to stick to the defaults value that the writer of the API is just giving you. But you can also specify additional options just calling some functions that will take your option and using a closure will act directly on the server just to modify the server configuration. And as you can see in the constructor of the server, new server, I'm just examining all the option you passed me just to apply this option and to modify the setting of the server. Okay. Now, let's return to the architecture of our HTTP service. Sticking to the Go standard project layout, we decided to separate the business logic that belongs to the short package that you can see under the internal directory. And you can also find the storage package that will hold all our let me say, proxies for the specific implementation of the storage we would like to use. And finally, we have an implementation of a server that supports the graceful shutdown, that supports the optional, the functional option pattern, and that can be reused in various situations. What we achieved now is somewhat similar to what is sometimes called hexagonal architecture. Since we decided that our application is complex enough, we decided to separate the business logic from the repository or storage layer. And finally, we separated it from the what is called HTTP ports to manage the communication with the external actors. If you think about it, the HTTP ports, specifically the YAML server, is just something now that is specifically managing the communication with external actors, encoding and decoding HTTP requests and response. And keeping this structure, it is very simple, just to adapt this service, not using HTTP, but using, as an example, gRPC, or using some other layer, transport layer that you'd like. And it is also very easy to switch to swap the storage from Badger to another database that you would like to use with the same logic and the same server. Okay, so to be clear, this architecture, as I said, gives us some nice advantages, as a clean separation of concerns, a good testability, and a good modularity that is the code reuse in our application. But to be true, it may be a little bit too complex for a small project. As I said before, for a URL shortener, maybe it is a little bit too much. Because if you take a look at the repository that is on GitHub, you may see that the logic is a few lines of code compared to the structure of the application. So you may think, and probably you are right, that this is a little bit of over-engineering. And the over-engineering is something that is the Go language is enforced to avoid, let me say. So besides, this kind of structure may impact your performance because there are a lot of interaction. And typically, when you have a lot of interaction, you will have more pointers, and when you have more pointers, you may have an higher activity for the garbage collection, and so you will you can see a decrease in your performance. Clearly, this has to be verified to benchmark. This has to be proved. Please don't guess performance is just looking at the code. But you should be aware that this approach may impact the performance of your service. Okay, so we don't have much time remaining, but I would like just to show you a little bit about the code here. And a nice thing that I would like to say, you can see that the structure of the repository is very similar to the previous one, to the BTools one. A nice thing that the Go team gives to us is the Go package repository, and here you can see that I have a badge, and I clicked on the wrong URL. Okay, so here I'm just looking at the code for my module that is rendered directly from the comments that are in a specific format in my repository. And here you can have some documentation regarding, as an example, the storage internal package. And here you can see the backend type, the Badger backend type with all APIs and so on. Another things that I would like to point out is the use of these. Sorry, I would need to get back to the Yaus repository. A nice thing that I would like to point out is the use of Go Report card, that is an online linter that will give you an evaluation of our code from E, I think, to A plus. And despite I suggest you to not blindly follow the suggestion of a linter, I think this is a useful linter that will try to give an immediate representation of the quality of your code. So it is good to have this immediate feedback, especially if you are working on a code that is quite large and it is manipulated from a quite large team or even open source. So I think this is nice, and I suggest to use it if possible. Besides, it's totally free, so it is nice for that too. Okay, so I think we can conclude. We are at the final thoughts. As I said before, achieving a good architecture and project layout is not something that you will be able to reach with the first iteration. To me, it's just, in my humble opinion, it's just an iterative process. And that's also because your software application hopefully will grow up in time, new features will be added, and so on. And every time you need to decide if a refactoring of your code, just to introduce some of the patterns I showed before, may be useful in your specific case. What is very important, in my opinion, is that a great quality for a developer is the stubbornness. And so you should be stubborn and try again just to find the best project layout and architectural patterns that fits your application the best. Okay, here you can find the slide with some further references that I would like to share, because I think that these are very nice articles to read. And so this is everything on my side. So I would like to thank you for your attention, and I'm ready to take your nasty questions for the rest of the time. Thank you very much.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Fabio, for that talk. All right. So now it is time, you guys, to answer all of those burning questions that you have. I know there were lots that we had in chat, so we'll go ahead and go through them all one by one. Let's go ahead and see the first one here. Let's see here. Okay. So the first one we have is by Denny, who says, why, for example, in the Cobra repository, there is no PKG directory, and how can we structure a reusable package?
Okay, as far as I know, in the Cobra package, you won't find such a directory, because Cobra is mainly a package that is developed not just a standalone application, but as a package itself. And I think this is the main reason. But anyway, for the second part of the question, if you have a package and you store it in the PKG directory, it will be accessible just with the root module path /PKG/ the name of our package. And I can share the screen, because I would like to show you how you can import. Here we are. Just take the package from BTools, the package bncode that is in the PKG directory. To import this package, you can write your application, and then you can just use this import line, github.com/people84. BTools, that is the main module path, and I take internal torrent. I didn't see that. I would I need to use this one. Okay, here we are. Here you can import the BNCode package in your inner code. So you just need to do that. It's as simple as that.
All right, thank you. We'll go to the next question by Mauro, who says, oh, we got to put the Q&A there. Here it is. Mauro asks, what is your opinion on GoMock and use some framework to implement dependency injection like Wire?
Okay, I'm sorry to disappoint you, but I don't have much experience with these two frameworks, well, packages or frameworks or whatever. I know them by name. What I can say regarding Wire, I can say that I tried to read a little about that, and I find it a little bit difficult to grasp. So in my opinion, it may be good to investigate more in that package, but I think you should have some, strict requirement. You should be really in need to experiment to have something to support dependency injection. In my experience, it is maybe because I've just been exposed to a project with a medium size and not very large scale project. I just prefer to stick to simpler things, just like define an interface and just like I did for the storage package to achieve those kind of results. So this is my opinion. Start from the simplest possible thing, and then just go outside and read about some ready-to-use framework, and also invest some time to study and to learn that framework if you feel that something is missing for yourself and for your requirements.
All right, thank you. Another one from Mauro is, in which directory would you put the data layer with this structure? Remember which context that was in.
Yeah. I think this question was one that I answered at least partially in the second part of the talk, because regarding the data layer, stick that in the internal directory using a specific package for your data layer. I will start doing that, and if things get more and more complicated, you can again use an interface, or you can have a look at the hexagonal architecture, because the proper hexagonal architecture is not the one I showed before, and it gives some more advantages, but it is quite complicated, and so you may want to look at that. But in my opinion, you should start from the structure I showed in the second application, and just keep the data layer in a separate package under the internal directory.
Excellent. Thank you so much. I see a few people are typing. Yep, we've got another question here from Julius. What is your opinion on Ginkgo as BDD testing framework?
Okay. Again, I didn't use this framework a lot, but I used it in the past, and I think it's a very good framework. And I'd suggest to use it, especially because writing those kind of tests helps a lot in understanding how an API is working and what to expect from that API. So I definitely suggest to use Ginkgo, and I would like to use it in my projects earlier in the future. So I hope I will have the occasion to use that again. So that's a plus for me.
Nice. Thanks for that. Good. All right. I see we have another one here, and they stopped typing. All right. I don't know if they are going to finish their question or not. For people, just as an announcement, while we wait for the next few questions to arrive, if they do, you can actually go ahead and continue this discussion on Discord if you don't have time now to stay. We will have the Discord up for a while, so you can definitely carry on the conversation there, definitely. All right, good. We have another one from Simone. He says, opinions about Testify. What are your opinions?
Okay. Even with Testify, again, I have to say that I tend to stick with the standard library, but I use Testify a little bit in the past, and I find it to simplify some things that is missing in the standard library. Even testing the code for these two applications, example applications I developed, I found that sometimes I would like to have some helpers just to test that a thing is equal to another, or this is, or just to write in a single line, I expect that this thing is equal to the next one, and if not, I would like to have a standard message to make the test fail. Even just like Ginkgo, Testify is thumbs up for me. But anyway, I think you could, if you don't have that extensive testing, I think that even the standard library can serve you quite well for unit testing.
Excellent. All right, another question here by Dario. Would you mind to share your opinion about GoKit?
Okay. I think GoKit is very interesting. I took a look at the structure. Something of my talk is based on what Peter Bourgon, the creator of GoKit, shared previously on a lot of talks in GopherCon and so on. I think it's a nice framework. And what I like about GoKit is that it's not... it is able to simplify some tasks without forcing you to use certain packages, certain technologies, and so on. And I think that if you need to develop some microservices architecture for an application, you should look into GoKit first. There are other frameworks that are interesting, but GoKit maybe is the sweet spot between having a comprehensive framework but not having something that is enforcing you too much in some architectural decision and some in using some technologies. So I think it is very interesting. And besides, I strongly suggest to follow the talk from Peter Bourgon, which is a very experienced Golang developer, and I think you can learn a lot from them.
Nice, thank you. All right, let's see here. I see one last person writing. So while we're waiting for that, did you have anything else you wanted to add? If not, I'll just say we have up above, or maybe to the side, I don't know, on your screen, but we have the Discord server. You can click on that to go ahead and ask more questions later if they come up. Okay, good. We have, were you going to say something, Fabio?
No, I was just reading the question, and the error handling is Go is quite a pain point. And I'll just share with you something about my personal developer experience. I always struggle to understand the new APIs that errors.is introduced in Go 1.13. But what I grasped until now is that you can use errors.is to compare the error that you received with the exact error you are you was expecting, and you should use error.as if you are if the error type just contains some field that that can be modified while creating the error, and this is a kind of compare will just be will just did in a in a recursive way, because you know that errors in Go can be wrapped, and you can receive an error that has originated in a very lower layer, and each layer can add some context to the error. So if you understand that, I think that I hope quicker than me, if you understand that, maybe the standard library is able to serve you quite well. I'm trying to use the new W format specifier for adding a context to the error I'm returning from the lower level, and I'm trying to use the is and as API from the errors package. But if so, if that is not enough for you, I think that a very good package for the error is the one from Dave Cheney. That I think that the new API for errors from the standard package is based on that. But I think that something is still missing, because the Go team finally decided not to integrate everything. So you may want to start from there and to have something more useful for the errors manager.
All right, thanks. We got another one here from John, who says, what's your opinion about Fiber Framework?
Okay, luckily I didn't have the possibility to experiment the Fiber Framework. It's just another nice framework that I would like to experiment. It seems a project that is very well maintained and battle tested, because it's used in production, and just like Micro, Invincible, and something like that. But unluckily, I didn't have the occasion to experiment with those framework. So the point is that every time you have to experiment with the framework, I think you should invest some time to learn how to use that framework in a proficient way. And in doing this time, in my opinion, is not immediate. Even if a framework is well structured, you need some time to be proficient using that framework. There are a lot of frameworks out there, and at the end of the day, if you don't have any clue, just read the framework specification. Just ask to the framework original authors, and finally just take a decision and try to stick with that for a certain time, because you will need some time to leverage the power of the framework. Unfortunately, I didn't have the time to do so for Fiber and many other frameworks out there, but maybe, who knows, next year in GoLab I will talk a little bit about them.
Sure. And you can also, you know, talk to other people in Discord. We're actually going to stop with the questions for now. So any questions you didn't get to have answered, we will have Fabio on the Discord. So we have the link up there again. If you want, Fabio will be there to ask any other questions you have. So thank you so much all for staying with us, for having great questions for Fabio to answer. And of course, thank you, Fabio, for your time and your expertise.
Thank you very much. Thank you for attending my talk. And I know that there was a lot of code. And if you have some other question, if you would like to discuss again regarding the specific implementation, there are the GitHub repositories, but specifically Discord server. I'll try my best to be present on the Discord server even in the further days. So I'll wait you there.
Excellent. All right. Well, you all, it has been wonderful. We hope you have enjoyed this seminar and that it has satisfied all of your curiosities. Like I said, you can go to the Discord server. Also, you can contact anyone on GoLab through info@golab.io, or you can follow us on the social networks. All righty. Well, you all have a great rest of your day, and you as well, Fabio. And we'll see you around, everyone. Take care.
Okay.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Thank you again.
Bye.